Well, hello everybody. It's always lovely to see you doing this, even though it's a strange way of doing it. It's becoming more and more normal and more familiar. So welcome to worship. Last week we said in the service, didn't we, that it is a recalibrating, a getting a sense of a bigger and a better and a more accurate perspective. So I'm here in Devon, just taking a couple of days away to get a better perspective on what's happening back at home. And that is worship in its own right, as long as we focus it on the God of Jesus Christ. So we're going to sing, we're going to listen about him, and we're going to study. We'll sing our first song together.
Tell out my soul the greatness of the Lord. Unnumbered blessings give my spirit voice tender to me. The promise of his word in God my Savior shall my heart rejoice.
Well, let me ask you, how's your lockdown hair going? I think some of us have felt the first thing we wanted to do was get our hair sorted out, get our roots dealt with, the length and the madness of our hair. But I'll tell you this, you know, we have our new lay worker coming, Dylan. He's got his tickets, he's got his visa. He'll be arriving back in the country very soon. And I don't care what his hair looks like. Now, don't you think that your God cares very little about what you look like, because he knows your heart. And we come before Almighty God now to thank him for a God who never judges us on what is on the outside, but what he does is he looks and values us by what is in our hearts. Let's bow our heads.
Loving Father, we come before you this day, acknowledging that you are beyond all space and time, ruler over all. Your power, mercy and love, you are greater than our minds can grasp. Sovereign Lord, we worship you. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your sharing of our humanity, experiencing our joys and sorrows, identifying yourself with us even to the point of death. Thank you for your sacrifice on the cross, God made flesh. We honor you. Spirit of God, you are constantly by us and in us, guiding us empowering us, working within us, transforming us, making us more like Christ. Holy Spirit, we acknowledge your presence with us. Holy God, we come to you, aware of our weakness, that we do not love as we should, we do not trust as we should, and we do not live as we should. Forgive us all that is past, and thank you that you forgive all who turn to you. Holy Trinity, give to us this day a sense of your greatness and gentleness, a glimpse of your nearness. Great and glorious God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we worship you. Amen.
Am I... can't kneel down in the middle of a highway and live to talk about it, son.
But why? Why now?
Bruce, you have the divine spark. You have the gift for bringing joy and laughter to the world. I know, I created you.
Quit bragging.
See, that's what I'm talking about. That's the spark.
What do you want me to do?
I want you to pray, son. Go ahead. Use them.
Lord, feed the hungry. And bring peace to all of mankind. How's that?
Great. If you want to be Miss America. Now, come on. What do you really care about?
Grace.
You want her back?
No. I want her to be happy. No matter what that means, I want her to find someone who will treat her with all the love she deserved from me. I want her to meet someone. We'll see her always, as I do now. Through your eyes.
Now that's a prayer.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's good.
It's good.
It's good. I'm gonna get right on it.
Well, I'm standing with my back to the mouth of the river Yelm. It's a sea finger, really, not much of a river at the far end. Nos Meo and Newton Ferrers are up there, if you know it. And it's a part of the world we know very well here. Millions of tons of water come flowing through in and here every tide. And every time we sing, it's like a force of nature rises up from the earth to God and comes back down to us with his love and encouragement. So we're going to sing again together.
That lifts my weary head. My consolation.
Hi everyone at Bodmin, Weybridge and Padstow Methodist Circuit. Just a short message from the Phipps family, just to say that we're moving on. We have finished our time in the tube station and we're moving down to Truro, where I've got a new job working for the Church of England. And Stevie's going to keep working in Newquay. But we just wanted to say thank you so much for being so inclusive, being so amazing when we bring Isla around. And just all the people that we visited and all the churches we preached in. You've just been so amazing and you're such a beautiful community and we will miss you all loads. Hopefully we'll see you again, but for now this is just a quick goodbye.
Yeah, we'll miss you loads. Thanks for being really so supportive of us and
Mummy
and Isla. Thank you so much. We'll miss you.
See ya. Bye.
Bye-bye. Say bye, Isla.
I'm standing at the foot of a cliff. It's not a particularly big one, but I wouldn't want to fall down it, mainly because of what's at the bottom and all this dangerous, sharp, jagged rocks down here at Wembley Beach. And now, cliffs don't play a big role in the New Testament. There's a few mentions in the Old. The only one I can think of in the New Testament is the one that they wanted to throw Jesus off when he stood up in front of the synagogue and told them that God have been calling people from outside their clan, their tribe, their people to follow him, and they wanted to kill Jesus for that reason. Well, if Jesus hadn't taught that, we would never know the joy and the freedom and the life that we've discovered through following him. So it looks like a serious cliff, this. Many thought it was so serious that everything would come to an end. Well, we're going to get through the issues that we're facing at the minute with the virus. In fact, Christians will get through everything because of him. But he said, pray to me, ask me, talk to me. Let's begin a conversation and focus and refocus your life on me by bringing even the things that look like a dangerous cliff to me. So we'll bring our concerns to him now.
Heavenly Father, we give thanks to you for all who labour for the coming in your kingdom. We pray for the visionaries, the preachers, the pastors, the evangelists and carers. We pray for those who witness to your grace at work in their communities and those who witness amongst friends and family. But we pray for those who are dispirited by the greatness of the task facing them, for all who are wearied by their work, for those with little human support, for all who work in lonely and dangerous places. We come with our tiredness and our weariness. Lord, we come to you. Give us rest and refreshment. We pray for all who have lost the joy and pleasure of living, for the bored, the cynical, and all who are jaded with life. We remember all who are overworked and stressed. We remember those who have lost their jobs and those who are seeking work. We pray for all who cannot relax and enjoy being themselves. Lord, we come to you. Give us rest and refreshment. Lord, make our homes places of peace and calm. May they be a place of safety, not just for us, but for all who enter our homes in the future. We pray for families where there is strife. We remember especially homes where domestic violence is a present reality. We pray for all who have left home due to violence and are rebuilding their lives. Lord, we come to you. Give us rest and refreshment. We pray for those who are anxious, for the depressed and the despairing, for all who are suffering from a breakdown. We pray for all who are no longer coping on their own. We come with our own burdens and needs. Lord, we come to you. Give us rest and refreshment. Father, we pray for those who are ill, and we pray for their healing. We give thanks for those who work in hospitals and care homes. Keep them safe. And we pray for all whose lives and hearts grieving at this time. Lord, we come to you. Give us rest and refreshment. Amen.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face to you and grant you peace. Amen.
Oh, great God, tonight. Just wanna know that everything will be alright. Oh great God, be close enough to feel you now. All praise and all the honor be to the God of ancient mysteries, whose every sign and wonder turned the pages of our history. But tonight my heart is heavy, and I cannot keep from whispering this prayer. Are you there?
So this week I'm taking a rest from producing the full online service and the written material this week, though we still managed to produce everything and we're using repeated material today. But what I have done is I've taken a shorter text from a chapter of a book that I return to again and again. It's Richard Foster's book on prayer. I've come back to that many times over my Christian life, and it reminds me, it teaches me, and it inspires me about the role of prayer that it can have in the Christian experience. We'll return to the Things That Do Not Change series, weeks 2 and 3, in future weeks. Paul, in one of his letters, the first letter to Thessalonians, it says this: rejoice always, pray continually, and give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Jesus Christ. Pray continually. I read that John Wesley used to get up early and pray for 3 hours a day, and very briefly, when I was accepted for training in the ministry, I had a go at that. It lasted about 3 days, and I have to tell you, I found the whole process exhausting and intimidating. I can't do that. I just can't. I'm just not good enough to do that. And it was such a freeing and wonderful experience for me to read Richard Foster's book about the different types of prayer. Because there are times when I've prayed a lot and I've really needed to when I've done it. And I suspect that listening to this, many of you have had times when you've had to pray a lot and you have, and there are times when you felt you ought to pray and you haven't. Well, you're in good company. You're in good company. All of us listening to this have issues with prayer. So I'm going to take a precede version of this first chapter in Foster's outstanding book on prayer, and that'll be the heart of what we're talking about today. We all believe as Christians that prayer is something we should do, even something we want to do. But it seems as if there is a chasm that stands between us and actually praying. We say that it's the lack of time that stops us, but we always seem to have time for food and for sleep and things like that. No, Foster says that it's something deeper that is what is preventing us from praying. And really, he says, it's the notion that we have to have everything just right in order to pray. Somehow our lives need fine-tuning, or we need a better grasp of the deeper and more philosophical aspects of prayer. But actually, when we pray in the most simple way, and he calls it simple prayer, it's the first of the 20 chapters he has on prayer, it's we come underneath, is the phrase he uses, where we calmly and deliberately and simply surrender control and become, well, we come being incompetent in it, and we allow ourselves to become the opposite of a spiritual giant. We come as an ignorant but honest child. One of the writers that he quotes says that to pray means to be willing to be naive in front of God. We all, when we come to God in prayer, we all come with a tangled mess of motives, both altruistic and selfish, merciful and hateful, loving and bitter, all of us. And we will never actually, in reality, unravel all the good from the bad in us. That's a lifetime, it's an eternity job. But God is big enough to receive us with all these things within our mixture. He's always received everyone, his heroes of scripture and the small ones like me involved in his modern church. He receives us all with that mixture, complex mixture of mixed motives. And his willingness to receive us that way is what grace means. Not only are we saved by grace that he allows us to come as a mess, but we live by grace. He knows that we aren't right yet. So when we come to pray, we pray by grace. Jesus reminds us that prayer is like children coming to their parents. Children ask for crazy things sometimes. And sometimes we are hurt by the selfishness of their requests. But we are simply glad, are we not, that they have come. And this is how it is with prayer. We will never have pure enough motives. Neither will we be good enough or know enough to pray rightly. To get to that standard, well, if we have an intimate, ongoing interaction with God through simple prayer, then he will deal with those matters in due course. But that isn't where we start. It's where we are going. No, we come just as we are. Is there really any other way that we can do it? God receives us just as we are, and he accepts our prayers just as they are. It's just as a child cannot draw a bad picture, so a child of God cannot offer a bad prayer. When we come with simple prayer, we don't try to sort things out, the good from the bad within us. We simply and unpretentiously share our concerns and make our requests to him. We tell God, for example, how frustrated we are with our co-worker or our neighbour, or even some within our own family, or a club, or a choir, or a society, or a church that we're part of. We ask for the simple and basic things of life. We ask for food. We ask for good weather. And we ask for good health. In a very real sense, we are the focus of simple prayer. Our needs, our wants, our concerns are bound to dominate our prayer experience when we come simply. Our prayers are therefore obviously shot through with plenty of pride and conceit and vanity and pretentiousness, haughtiness, and general all-round egocentricity. But also, no doubt, you will bring moments of magnanimity and generosity, unselfishness, caring, love, and a sense of goodwill. So when we come before God and pray, he expects us to make lots of mistakes. He expects us. But if we fail and fall down, well, we get up again and we try again. One of the writers many years ago called simple prayer the prayer of beginning again. A bit like diets. We're always starting them, aren't we? We start a lot more than we finish. And we start a prayer life far more often than we complete one. But this simple prayer, it's encouraging to me that it is the most common type of prayer that we find throughout Scripture. Ordinary people bringing ordinary concerns to a loving and compassionate Father with no pretense, no show, no drama. We do not pretend to be more holy than we actually are when we come simply. And we don't try to hide and conceal our conflicting and contradictory motives from God or from ourselves. Simple prayer is the beginning prayer. It is indeed the prayer of children. And even those who have been praying for many years, even those who are mature, wise, and deep in the things of God, in the things of the spiritual life, they often return again and again to the simple prayer. In fact, Jesus commands us to. He asks us to return to this kind of praying when he urges us to ask for daily bread. No one has ever outgrown the need for that. So no one ever outgrows the need for this kind of prayer. We never outgrow the needs which give rise to it. Simple prayer is necessary, even essential, to the spiritual life. And those that sometimes leap over this kind of thing to a more sophisticated and noble prayer life are unlikely ever, says Foster, to have really prayed at all. So where do we begin? Well, Foster says you begin from where you are. We begin right where we are. I wish, he says, that that didn't sound so trivial. We tend to believe that God cannot bless me here and now. Maybe later. But the only place God can bless is where we are, isn't it? Because that's the only place that we actually are. It is the most natural and simple way possible. We learn to pray our experiences by taking up the ordinary events of everyday life and giving them to God. It means that we should feel perfectly free to complain to God, or perhaps argue with God, or even shout at him. C.S. Lewis, who's written a couple of tremendous books on prayer, he said this: lay before God what is in you, not what ought to be in you. And we must never, ever believe the lie that says the details of our lives are not the proper content of prayer. I urge you, says Foster, to carry on an ongoing conversation with God about the daily stuff of life. Don't worry about proper praying. Just talk to God. He delights in our presence. And we will then discover that by praying, we learn to pray. It's a bit like what we said a few weeks ago about my future son-in-law, Johnny, that he improvised and something remarkable happened. We improvise prayer, but not as a great performance. The video clip we saw earlier from Bruce Almighty. He tried to perform great. He said, what kind of prayer is that? Is it a good prayer? Great prayer, says God, who of course is Morgan Freeman. Great prayer if you want to be Miss America. But tell me about the things that are really going on in your life, he says. There's some real depth in that little, funny little passage. We will discover by praying that that is how we learn to pray. Foster always has some practical advice to help us with these things. And I'll just give you one or two of these, if I may. He says this: prayer is nothing more than an ongoing and growing love relationship with God. Nobody has any advantage. It is an intimate, private relationship. Years do not necessarily make it better. No one has an advantage, whatever their position in the church may be. And you need never be discouraged by your lack of prayer. I mean, amazing, isn't it? We very quickly feel a failure, but we shouldn't, because we don't need to. Even in our prayerlessness, we can have a hunger for knowing God better, for having done better. And if that is so, then you can recognize that that reminder, that need, that hunger is somehow itself a prayer. The desire for God is the prayer of desire. Don't be discouraged by the hardness of your heart. You might find it difficult, or it may even be cynical when you begin. But prayer will soften your heart. For you see, we even give our lack of prayer to God. Another thing, and this was a tremendous help for me: let go of trying too hard to pray. There is a principle of progression in the spiritual life. There is a sin of spiritual greed, wanting more of God than he can be digested. If prayer isn't yet a fixed habit within you, instead of starting with 12 hours of prayer-filled dialogue, single out just a few moments and put all your energy into those few moments. And when you have had enough, tell God simply, I must have a rest. I don't have the strength to be with you all the time. I mean, if you were to meet a great hero of yours, you wouldn't want to go on a holiday for a week with them, would you? I mean, to be honest, I think an hour would be more than enough to meet somebody really famous and really capable. You would come before God. Of course you can't pray all day. Of course it's too much for us. He gently invites us in. He knows what we can and can't take. Foster says that we can learn to pray even when we are dwelling on evil, when we are angry, bitter, agonizing, waging a war within our interior life. We don't need to isolate that from prayer. In fact, we can even give him our downright disobedience, things that we know we are harboring in our hearts that are wrong. The Lord loves us, perhaps most of all, when we are failing, but want to try again. Nothing is outside the subject matter of prayer. And the last piece of advice is this: it is wise to strive for uneventful prayer experiences. Divine words from God, revelations and ecstasies that we hear about or see on certain videos. Well, those things which clearly do exist for a few, well, they can overwhelm the whole experience. They can distract us from the real work of prayer. A far better approach is that of the psalmist who sought to avoid marvels beyond our capacity. He says, "It's enough for me to keep my soul tranquil and quiet, like a child in its mother's arms." Simple prayer is often ignored in books and teaching on prayer. A legitimate fear is that we can become self-consumed with it, that we only talk about ourselves, and that is something to be nervous of. So we must move with some caution, but not turn back. In the beginning, we are indeed the subject and the centre of our prayers, but slowly the centre of our whole life changes. We pass from thinking of God as part of our life to the realisation that we are part of His. God moves from the periphery of our prayer life to the centre. And that's how there is a conversion of our heart. Simple prayer is the beginning of this. It's epicentre. It's ground zero. And it is a place where everyone can and must begin. Now, if you know this with your head, but you cannot yet live this out in reality, then this week can be a fresh start. It can be. Especially if you feel not again. Especially if you feel that you're a failure. Especially if you feel poor in spirit. Because you can bring any of those feelings to Him in prayer. So bring your anger and your boredom. You can bring your fear and your frustration, and you can even bring Him the minutiae of tomorrow, because you'll be bringing it to a God who knows the smallest of things and the largest of things. And He created you to do precisely this, so that He will become the centre of your life and you join in the true story, the true subject, and you'll be in the true care of the one who can answer these prayers. Amen.
Oh,
let's share the grace together. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each one of us now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Well, keep on going. Make sure you get an appointment and get there early for your hair. You never know how it's going to end up. And we do look forward to seeing one another again. The tube station actually is open during the week, 10 till 4. Social distancing rules strictly apply and takeaways only. But that's where we've started, to open up as a circuit. But let's see, we'll always have our hearts open to him and to each other. So keep on going. See you all soon. God bless. Bye-bye.